Let's start by creating a reference system for the pointed arch with a circle facing the side view and the snapping tool turned on increment. Duplicate the circle and make it so its leftmost point touches the origin of the first circle, creating an intersection to be used as a guide for a nice equilateral pointed arch. To do so, hit Shift A and add another circle with 24 vertices. Tab into edit mode and rotate it by 90 degrees on the y-axis. Enable the snapping tool also for the scaling and scale it down until it is completely encompassed within the intersection. Delete the lower half, select the highest point, and with proportional editing on with linear falloff, move it up, helping yourself with the score wheel to try and match the reference as precisely as possible. Be careful though not to move the vertices at the base. Push the outline of the arch on the x-axis, add an empty and rotate it by minus 45 degrees on the z-axis. Place a mirror modifier on the arch with the empty as the target, go to the top view, move the outlines on the x-axis until they touch each other and push them back a few units to create a bit of space. Apply the mirror modifier, select the empty, hit Alt-R to reset its rotation and move it up right where the top of the arch is, to use it as a reference to identify where the ribs shall meet. Add yet another circle with the same number of vertices as before, which in my case is 24. Delete again the lower half and rotate it by minus 45 degrees on the Z-axis. From the top view, hit S and Shift-Z to scale it but on the Z-axis. Our goal here is to create this 90 degrees angle among the different profiles. Set the pivot point on the 3D cursor and scale the half circle down on the Z-axis until you match the reference. Let's join everything together and delete all but the bottom right corner of the structure. We can now connect the edge loops, add the mirror modifier on both the X and Y axis with the clipping option turned on, shade smooth, add a subdivision modifier to smooth out the curvature, and a bevel modifier on top of that set on weight. Select the ribs and the arch profiles, and from the side panel give them a weight of 1. Lastly, take care of the edges at the bottom with some crease, and the base of the vault is basically done. And check whether the normals are correctly pointed inward, as this will be an indoor shot. To create the profiles of the ribs and the arches, I'm selecting the corresponding loops on the vault. Shift D to duplicate and P to separate them from the rest. We can remove the bevel and mirror modifiers as well as any crease or custom weight, and finally convert the profiles into curves from the Object tab. This will allow us to easily assess the correct size of each profile by manipulating the bevel depth value in the Object Data Properties tab to make them converge without any unwanted compenetration. I'll then separate the ribs and the arches to control them individually and to make the latter a bit more prominent in size. Let's now work on the profile of the ribs by activating the wireframe option from the Object Property tab, and by adjusting the curvature of the rib where needed to make it coherent with the overall shape of the vault. You can use proportional editing with smooth falloff and play along with the gizmo to obtain the desired result. Once happy, convert back to mesh and tab into edit mode. At this point, you can play with extrusions along the normals, just remember to do the necessary cleanups, and remember that you can always hit Shift-B and drag a box to focus and pivot your view. Another useful tool when working with profiles is to use the Alt-S command to scale along the normals. Once done, join the ribs back to the vault. To take advantage of the mirror modifier already in place, add an additional edge loop at the end and delete the corresponding faces to create space for the clef. Speaking of which, I just started from a cylinder, placed it into position and created a few edge loops with some extrusions to reinforce the overall look of the structure. Moving on to the profile of the arches, I'm deleting one of the two guides as we won't need it. Enable again the wireframe option from the Object Properties tab, select all and apply a 15 degree tilt to the curve with Ctrl-T to make use of these three frontal face loops when building the profile. As with the ribs, adjust the curvature where needed, convert back to mesh and start building the profile using the same tools as before. To make it work, we'll need to straighten the final edge loop on the y-axis, resize and reposition. Add a mirror modifier with the clipping option turned on, and bring the two halves together. We can use again the subdivision modifier and a bevel modifier on top of that to finalize the shape. apply the mirror modifier, add an empty and rotate it by minus 45 degrees on the z-axis. Add back a mirror modifier on both the x and y-axis, target the empty, and the vault is finally complete. To model the cluster columns, and since they are ideally the continuation of the profiles we just built, I'm selecting again the relevant edge loops on the vault, duplicating and separating them from the rest of the composition. I'll remove as well any crease or weight and add an array modifier to get them all in place. Tab into edit mode, circle select the bottom vertices and extrude them down. With this selection active, circle select again the vertices at the base, Ctrl I to invert the selection, X and delete vertices. Convert them to curves, bring back the vault and place a temporary array modifier on that too. You can again manipulate the bevel depth to define the size of the columns, select those representing the continuation of the ribs, go to the bottom view, scale them down on the x-axis and reposition them on the y-axis to make them sit deeper into the composition. Lower the resolution to 2 and convert them back to meshes. Select the frontal and the side columns and press S and Shift Z to make them slightly bigger. At this point, we can change the pivot point to individual origins and start shaping the profiles as desired. For the shading, we can in this case avoid using subdivisions, just add a bevel modifier, enable harden normals from the shading submenu and check auto smooth in the vertex data tab. To build the side panel, I will borrow one of the arches outlines, delete all modifiers but the mirror on the x-axis, apply it, remove any crease and move it back to the center. I can then hit E to extrude and Alt-S to scale along the normals a couple of times to create a bit of thickness. Change the pivot point to the 3D cursor, enable the snapping tool on increment and start positioning and resizing the mesh to cover one half of the panel. Add a mirror modifier on the x-axis with clipping turned on, change now the snapping method to on vertex, progressively select each vertex on the outer edge loop of the arch profile, hit G and the relevant axis and hover the mouse over the vertex you want to align it to. Once finished, move everything back in place, select the top edge loop and start extruding upward, trying to keep the overall topology as uniform as possible. Press K to enable the knife tool, cut the mesh along the profile of the side arch, circle select and delete the redundant faces and push inward the vertices which are still sticking out. We can cut a hole in the middle with the integrated loop tools add-on by right-clicking, selecting circle and deleting the corresponding faces. Remember to recompute your normals if needed and make sure they are facing the desired direction. I then proceeded to finalize the shape, create some contours and crease a few edges. And with the side structure in place, it is now time to think about some of the common decorations you would see in a Gothic building. To create the typical quaterfoil embellishment, start with a circle, scale it down and move it away from the center. Add an empty, rotate it by 45 degrees, add a mirror modifier on both the x and y axis, target the empty and turn clipping on. Move the circle back toward the center until the shapes start merging and apply the mirror modifier. Delete the inner vertices and make sure there is no loose vertex. Select the entire edge loop, duplicate it and scale it up. To make the distance between the two edge loops uniform, just play around with the Alt-S and S transforms until you're satisfied. At this point, select the two edge loops and hit Ctrl-E and bridge edge loops. Relax some of the vertices at the corners and finalize the shape with the help of a mirror modifier and some bevels. For the pointed trefoil, I'm again using two intersected circles, this time merging overlapping vertices directly and deleting those in excess. Extrude down the two vertices at the base and scale them slightly inward. Add an empty, rotate it by 120 degrees, and use it as a target of an array modifier placed onto the mesh. Push now the shapes closer and connect the vertices at the corners. You can then repeat the same steps already used when building the quaterfoil. To complete the structure, I added these small columns to the side panel to function as a standing base for the pointed trefoil decoration. I then enriched the latter with an additional arch profile, redefined the height of the whole structure, created a base for the side panel and added a floor using a plane with the exact same size of the vault. Lastly, I mirrored all the pieces at the side of the structure to finish up the composition. It is now time to bring everything into real-world scale. I'll add a cube, enable the edge length tool in the overlays and scale it up to the desired size. Select all the pieces of the composition, tab into edit mode, bring them up where the floor is, change the pivot point to the 3D cursor and scale according to the reference. In order to arrange our modular pieces into array formations and still keeping our polycount as low as possible, we need to organize our file by creating an additional collection and within that two additional sub-collections, one for the pieces that will need a definite number of array iterations and one to contain the meshes that will need that same number plus one. Let's duplicate the floor twice, one for each group, and use this as the driver for the array modifier. Distribute the meshes into the two groups considering that only the cluster columns and the main arch profile will need to be placed into the second group. As such, remove the mirror modifier on the x-axis for the columns to avoid overlapping meshes later on. Select the main arch, apply the mirror modifier, separate the side profiles from the one at the front, and for the same reason as before, just keep the first frontal profile. Parent now all the individual pieces to the placeholder planes. In the Object Property tab, under Instancing, select On Faces and disable the visibility on both the viewport and the render. Add an array modifier, be sure to repeat the steps for both planes and you should be good to go. Lastly, right-click on each group and select Instance to Scene. Move the created instance into the main collection and disable the Instances collection from the viewport. Let's conclude this video with a couple of texturing tips. For the vault, you want the pattern of the bricks or whatever material you're using to follow the direction of each vault subsection. To do so, simply place your seams onto the diagonal edge loops and unwrap. The islands will be oriented in the same direction in the UV space, which means that once they're rotated in the 3D view, the overall desired effect is obtained. If you notice some stretching, simply select again the seams and hit Shift-E to crease. For the ribs, it is sufficient to create a discontinuation by deleting some face loops at the back. You need your UV islands to be as straight as possible, as by bending over the 3D model, they will give the nice stacked bricks effect. Remember that you can straighten a UV island by looking for the most regular quad possible, right-clicking and selecting Follow Active Quads. To texture the arch profiles, since we have a clean outline at the bottom, it will be sufficient to run a seam at the top and unwrap. Straighten again your UV islands and that's all. And that would be it for this video. I hope you enjoyed the content and see you next time.